Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to our OPSI Colloquium. It's a special pleasure for me today to welcome our today's speaker, Daniele Faccio from Heriot Watt University in Scotland. So Daniele received his degree in physics in 98 in Milan. Then he worked for a couple of years in the industry, I think Pirelli, before he became professor at University of Insubria in Como, Italy. He won prestigious ERC fellowships and spent a year in ICFO, Barcelona, and then he moved in 2010 to Edinburgh. He became full professor in 2013, okay, and he built what is very thriving, very strong, beautiful group. They do lot of things, from nonlinear optics to gravitational physics modeled by optics, to gravitational effects in photonic states, quantum imaging, quantum information, and many other things. Their work was widely recognized. They even made it to the cover of a special issue here. So what you see here is, I think this is Daniel's student at the cover of the magazine. Hey? And we all know here in this country how important is it to make it to the cover of a magazine. So I should also mention that Daniel was a last year recipient of the Leverhulme Prize in Physics. This is a prize which is given to already well-known scientists who nevertheless show extremely good promise for the future. And you were also recently elected to be fellow of the Edinburgh Royal Society. I said that it was a very special pleasure for me because I have known Daniel for many, many years. I have seen some of his work, a little bit of it up close, but I admire all of it. And I do know that you, ladies and gentlemen, are in for a treat today. Daniel.
Thank you. Thank you for the very, very kind introduction. So I had some various topics that I could choose from, but I was asked to talk about our sort of more recent work, sort of the interface between photography and time. And so I hope I don't run out of time. I promise, Mira's promised to sort of stop me when time does run out. However, I do know that during long talks, at least my personal preference or my personal way of keeping awake is to put my hand up and ask questions. So please do feel free, or do interrupt me. Do try and make this interactive. If you are falling asleep, put your hand up and ask it a question, even if it's irrelevant. At least you'll wake up. It'll be fine. So I want to talk about photography and time. This is a picture of the first ever photograph taken by Nicéphore Niecks. This was taken in Le Gras, in France, very close to where I got my PhD from. This picture took 3 days to take, so very long time. Okay, and what I'll be talking about is somewhere at the complete opposite end of the spectrum, where we're looking at very short timescales. Nevertheless, this was a pivotal moment in general, I'd say, in history. I mean, nowadays, I mean, our society is very much information-driven, and I would argue that nearly all of that information is through images. For younger people, having a phone with a camera probably means nothing. You take it for granted, but I can assure you that for the older people, including myself, we notice this is a big revolution. Okay, images are all over the place. That wasn't always the case. Then came sort of the second big moment in imaging history. You've probably all seen this. This is a series of photographs taken by Edward Muybridge of a horse that is running. The goal here was to try and settle a bet regarding whether all four hooves of the horse leave the ground or not when it's running. And no one could see this because the legs of the horse are moving so fast when it's running, the human eye has a refresh rate of about 30 hertz, just simply can't capture that motion in real time. So he needed to come up with a nifty trick. He places a series of traps, if you want, so tripwires that triggered cameras that had very fast mechanical shutters, and he was able to take take these pictures and win the bet. Now, we over the years, this technology has been improved upon, and we now can take, you've seen similar pictures around, where we can even capture objects that are moving at just above supersonic speeds, and so you can see these Mach cones and shock waves. People use this to create art. Okay, and the principle is the same. You're always using these very fast mechanical shutters. In one version or another, the electronic or mechanical, it makes little difference. But capturing something that's moving at roughly the speed of sound is kind of the current limit of what's commercially available nowadays. So I want to take this to the extreme. So we can capture, we know how to take a photograph of a bullet or of a splashing drop of liquid. But think about what happens, for example, when you switch on the lights in a room. Okay, so it's very simple. There's nothing else going on here. There is light. You're switching on a light bulb, and there is light propagating. We know that light moves at a finite speed. So it's not infinite speed. So what the question is, what is really happening, and do we have any methods, any technique to visualize what is going on? So the idea is that, you know, you switch on the light, if you're able to really make a proper slow motion movie, you'd see the sphere of light expanding outwards in all directions. Okay, no one's ever seen that. Do we have, because you know, it's much, well, light is traveling a million times faster than the speed of sound, so how do you go about trying to even think about visualizing something like that? And if you can do, some of the questions I want to try and answer during this talk today is, if you do have that kind of technology, what can you do with it that you couldn't do before? So that brings me to the title of my talk. What I'll be talking about is imaging at the speed of light. Of course, clearly this lead-up is sort of just an introduction to point towards the fact that, yes, we can image at the speed of light, and what can we do? What can we do with that? Now, clearly, if you want to do something or create something which is, you know, I said the speed of light is a million times faster than the speed of sound. So if you want to do something which is a million times better than what you've got, it's not by tweaking the electronics or fiddling around with something in the lab that you're going to make that kind of improvement. You need to take a radically new approach to what you're doing. So, and this new approach that we've taken here is to use single photon counting technology. And it might not be immediately obvious as to why this is the solution that you need to tackle this kind of problem, but we'll go through the details of how that is. So this is just a picture of the naked camera. There's no boxing or anything. This is just an electronics board, and everything is happening here. So this is, you have a sense of scale here, but the chip is roughly 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter. It doesn't have very many pixels at the moment. It's only 32 by 32 pixels. So not a fantastic image. New cameras are coming out from our collaborators at Edinburgh University, where we have hundreds by hundreds of pixels. So the image quality is getting better. But I'll show you that actually for many applications, we've kind of gone up the scale in terms of trying to increase the pixel count. And now we're actually, as I'll show you later on, going back to sort of like single pixel ideas. So what I'll be showing you in the next several slides is I'll be continuously referring to this setup here. This is an actual photograph from the lab. This green beam is not a CW laser. It's a pulse laser. It's a laser going with a few kilohertz repetition rate. You see it as a continuous beam because it's just waving a piece of paper in its path and integrating in time. But it's essentially what the eye or any other camera would see because you have no way of freezing the motion of that pulse of light as it travels, bouncing back and forth through the mirrors. So this is how sort of the camera and the main idea works. We have these three mirrors that I was showing you in the photograph, a pulse light laser source. The pulses bounce off the mirrors. As they do so, every now and again, they'll interact with just the molecules, the air molecules, and scatter a photon towards the camera. So it's single. Every single pixel here is sensitive to a single photon. And the way these pixels work is they have embedded electronics that allows to very precisely time the arrival of each individual photon. Okay, the big difference between an analog sensor and a single photon sensor is that when you're detecting single photons, you're treating light as a particle. And I often sort of give this image. The difference is it's a bit like if you have a train passing through a platform at a train station, and I ask you, a very long train, and I ask you to tell me exactly the arrival time or the passage time of the train, and you're left with a problem. You know, do I take the click from the front of the train, the end of the train, the middle of the train? What do I do? And that's where, if you want, that's where time uncertainty comes from when you're measuring analog signals. But if you're measuring a photon, gives off a click, then you've got a use that to provide a very precise time reference of when the photon hit the camera. Okay, and that's where the timing comes in. So we're using single photon technology not only as a means to detect very low levels of light. Actually, we often end up, that's not always the problem we're trying to face here. Often we end up putting filters to reduce the level of light to not saturate the camera. The real trick is that we're using the fact that photons give off clicks on these detectors to give us very precise timing information. Okay? And the neat thing about this, so if anybody's familiar with quantum optics or how people go about doing quantum optics measurements in the lab, a bit of technical jargon, we're essentially working in the TCSPC, so time-correlated single-photon counting mode. You have a detector, which is, so each individual detector is a reverse-biased avalanche diode, it's a SPAD. So it's reverse biased, photon comes in and you get a photon, you get an electron avalanche. Okay, and then there's a quenching mechanism that switches that off. But the system is triggered by, for example, a TTL signal from your laser, and then it's switched off by the arrival time of the photon. Now, usually when you go out and buy a single photon detector and a TCSPC electronic system, you will end up with, well, the detector will be this size, and the TCSPC will either be a big card that you have to stick in a computer or be a box sort of this size. And the total will come out at, like, roughly, if you get high-end equipment, it can easily, quickly get up into the $40,000 region, okay? And that's just for one pixel. What we have here is, thanks to the CMOS technology that's been being used here, every individual pixel is a SPAD with all of its TCSP electronics directly integrated onto each individual pixel. Okay, so essentially we have 1,024. You can imagine trying now to build up 1,024 picoquant TCSPC modules. It would fill the room and it wouldn't be very useful. So everything's integrated into this single chip. Okay, so what you get out of this, out of a measurement like this, essentially, so it's another detail. There's a slight drawback. So the advantage is that you can, with this kind of electronics, you can get picosecond timing resolution of the arrival time of your single photons. The drawback is, because this is inherent, there's an inherent sort of problem in detecting photons, is that it's a statistical process. If you want to build up the shape of a photon, one measurement isn't enough. You need to repeat the measurement many times. And that's many, many times, millions of times, ideally. Okay? And so what you actually build up is, so if we just look at one spatial pixel, here you have the time axis. What you end up, what you try to build up is a histogram of detection events. And this histogram, the shape of this histogram, gives you essentially the shape of your photon, and the peak will give you sort of the average arrival time of the photons on your detector. Okay? So typically what you will be doing, this is differently from this camera, which uses passive illumination. Okay, it just uses the light of the environment to make a picture. Here, you have to use active illumination. You have to have a laser pointed at the system, illuminate the system with your pulse laser. Okay, that's usually not a problem, though. We have easy access to megahertz lasers, hundreds of megahertz, even gigahertz. So you can quickly acquire it. You can still acquire your millions of counts in less than a second to build up a full space and time resolved image. Okay? So these are pictures, data taken from a relatively old version of the camera. I just want to give you an idea of what the raw data looks like. Nobody ever shows you the raw data out of these things, and it looks better, but not that much better. So the raw image looks terrible, and admittedly it is, but the first thing you do is you subtract the background, and now you can start to see a trace of the laser pulse bouncing back and forward between the mirrors. if I take single individual pixels and look at what I have along the time axis, you see the histograms. And what you can then do is make a reasonable assumption on the fact that your photon has a Gaussian shape. So I just fit the data with Gaussians. I'm doing this mainly because you can see it allows me to remove all this noise. Okay, if I just keep my fits and throw away the data, I've removed all this. So this is kind of like a time cleaning process where the data analysis allows me to remove the noise. Where there is no populated histogram, I can simply fit with a straight line, the flat line, and completely remove the data. And if you look at what I end up with, it's a much nicer and cleaner image. Okay? And then there's this very last step, which is not necessary. It certainly doesn't, although it looks better, this is not adding any information. Okay, this is just a Photoshop interpolation, if you want. It makes it look better, but you're not actually adding any information. So this is the final result. This is the kind of video you can get. Laser pulse bouncing between these mirrors. This is the field of view. And this is the first ever video of a laser pulse propagating in free space. There had been sort of other measurements before this trying to capture what is called light in flight. There are techniques based, for example, on holographic techniques where sort of a laser pulse was shown across a wall and then photons reflected from the wall were collected. Others, the group at MIT, used a street camera to try and image again a light pulse. But if you look carefully what they're showing, the light pulse is propagating through essentially it's a Coke bottle filled with milk. So in order to have enough scattering so that they could actually see what was going on. This is free space. Okay. Of course, if I was to put this in vacuum, I'd see nothing. There's still some scattering, and that's what I'm detecting here. Okay, so another example, closer to some of the work Mir has been doing. Field of view, very high intensity laser pulse, 800 nanometers propagating and focusing here and generating a plasma in air. And you can see how the plasma lingers on because it has a relatively slow decay time with respect to the transit time of the laser pulse. Another curiosity that we tried looking at, a laser pulse propagating down a fiber. So this is a photonic multimode photonic crystal fiber. 800 nanometer femtosecond pulse are coming in here. This is like a standard picture that you can find all over the place. And you can see as the pulse goes around the cell, the nonlinear cell phase modulation effects accumulate and the color of the laser pulse gradually shifts from red, green, all the way into the blue. What does this look like if you try to freeze the pulses in motion? Here you see two pulses going through because of the 100 megahertz repetition rate. But you can clearly see as it moves along, it changes color. Interestingly, you can see that there, let's wait till the end, you can clearly see that there's a pulse chirp here. It's red, green, and blue at the back. So this, by the way, I should mention, the backgrounds are all just iPhone images that are overlaid onto the data from the camera, and the color information here is obtained in exactly the same way that color information is obtained with your iPhone camera. We just put colored filters and then repeat. In this case, we don't have a buy-in pattern to put on the individual pixels. What we're doing is, in this case, we took, I think it was 8 individual measurements with 8 different interference filters, therefore selecting each one its own color, and then you superimpose them. And you can do this because you're always referencing each measurement to a trigger coming from the laser. So you can look at this, for example, you can go and look in more detail at this chirp, and you can pull out, for example, the group velocity dispersion of your fiber just with this standoff detection technique. So you can find a few more details. Not all of the results I just showed you, but some of the details can be found in this Nature Comms paper that we published in early 2015. Other things that we've been looking at, for those of you familiar with slow light here, we're just sending in a laser pulse which is tuned between an absorption doublet in rubidium, huge dispersion, and that gives rise to extremely low group velocity, so you can slow light down by many orders of magnitude. You can even stop light if you play your tricks properly. Here we were just slowing light down by a factor roughly 300. So we just have a laser, an EOAM that chops the beam into pulses, and the wavelength is just tuned to be in the middle of this absorption doublet, and then we're just looking from the side of the camera. And this is what you see. This is the reference pulse in air. And you can see that for different slowing down ratios, I see these pulses. The one propagating vacuum is basically gone ages ago, and you can see the little pulses. You can very clearly see how the pulse is compressed in space and is moving a lot, lot slower. So let's come to those are sort of more curiosities. What I want to talk about now is sort of like one of the bigger and applications that we're dealing with at the moment, attracting a lot of funding, a lot of interest, I think, for, as you'll see, for pretty obvious reasons. So coming to the question that I posed at the very beginning of my talk, we've got all this fancy stuff, you know, you can see slow light, and you can see that's all, or I can see a light pulse propagating in air, that's all very well, but what can I do with this that is actually useful? What can I do with this technology that couldn't be done before? Okay, and I think that's when something, you know, you find something really interesting. It's not just about doing something that you could already do, but doing it a bit better. Or we have this million-fold increase, groundbreaking technology, completely different approach to imaging. What can we do with it that we couldn't do before? So I would argue that this is a big answer to that question. What I'll show you is that we can use this kind of technology, we can use the timing to form images of what is hiding behind a wall. Okay, so how do we do this? The idea is not actually too dissimilar from the sort of the concept behind how bats, dolphins, or even submarines are completely blind, actually manage to find the way around. Okay, so these animals will emit clicks of sound, and all they'll do is just simply sort of time how long it takes for the click to go out, hit an object, and come back again. Okay? And then they use their brains to sort of figure out from not only the timing, but also the shape, and we'll come back to that, of the reflected signal to determine what's in front of them. We would be doing, and this is essentially, I'm going to recognize that this is sort of the basic, the working principle behind LIDAR, and we'll be doing something similar, clicks of sound now, but clicks of light, pulses of light. And the idea is that instead of trying to visualize what's within the direct line of sight, we want to visualize what's behind a corner. So how do you do this? So imagine a fairly simple scene where you have, this is Terry, apparently, that's what the students called him. So he's hidden behind a wall, and let's assume I don't have access to the room. So there is an opening. There has to be an opening because light has to somehow get into that closed room. But let's assume I'm not allowed to move over here. So the only thing I can do with my camera is train it either on the wall over here or let's for a moment just stick with the idea that I'm looking at a certain region on the floor. Okay? Then I can take my laser pulse and also, I mean, likewise, the only thing I can do is shine my laser pulses onto the floor. Okay? So seen from the top, what is going on here is that every time a laser pulse hits the ground, it will scatter into a sphere of light. Okay, and these are 100 femtosecond pulses, so I'll have a sphere. You need to imagine you have this 100 femtosecond thick sphere of light expanding outwards. It will hit whatever's hidden behind the wall, and this in turn will reflect back another spherical wave. And this spherical wave will pass through the field of view of my camera. Okay, and because I have this ability to freeze light in motion, I will be able to take images. I'll have a whole video of this, actually, as this wavefront passes through my field of view. But if I just take one sort of time bin, what I'll see is an image of this wavefront as it's passing through the field of view of the camera. And that's all I need. This is all the information I need to precisely reconstruct the position of this object. If I have multiple, if there's some structure in the object, I'll have multiple spherical waves which are reflected backwards, and you can then devise an algorithm that backpropagates this information and can actually pull out a full 3D image of what's hidden behind the corner. So to give you a feel of what these spherical waves actually look like, here's a video, again, just the three mirrors, slightly different configuration, but it's the same thing. Pulse comes in here and bounces off these two mirrors. This is raw data, that's why it looks so pixelated. And you see as it bounces off, but that's with some delay, you see these spherical waves? So these are the waves that I'm talking about. these waves, they look, the timing looks very weird with respect to the laser pulses because they're originating from very weak scattering that's occurring on your mirror. We discovered that no matter how well you try to clean your mirrors, there is always, for some reason, some layer of something. I don't know if it's grease or dirt or whatever. But some, although most of the light gets reflected off into your coherent light pulse, there is always some very weak, now I'm talking about 0.1% of your light pulse that goes into a spherical wave, propagates outwards, and then there's a piece of cardboard in the background here. What you're seeing is the intersection of this spherical wave as it hits the cardboard wall. Okay? So the idea then is you can clearly see that the camera is able to really capture full video of these things. Now, clearly the first one that you saw was very open. It corresponds to this mirror over here, which is very far away. You'll see the next guy. You see the curvature of this guy is much larger, meaning that it's coming from somewhere closer. I mean, you can already very intuitively understand how this works. Now, a computer has to do a little bit extra work here, but the algorithm is extremely simple, to the point that we just got referee reports in last week where the referees were complaining that our retrieval algorithm was too simple. So I don't know what that means, but they were trying to reject us on the basis that this is too easy. So this is what it is. Essentially, as Miro put it the other day, this is essentially sort of a form of ground-based GPS, if you want. It's just triangulation. I have my target, my object hiding here. This is the laser spot where I'm shining the laser, and this is one of the pixels, for example. Let's just look at what happens at one pixel. And I know that, essentially, I know that the distance from here to here plus the distance from here to here, that's these two terms, just has to be equal to the flight time multiplied by the speed of light. Okay? Now, this equation here is a very simple mathematical equation. That's what I think annoyed our referee. Too simple. It's just an ellipsoid. Okay? And this ellipsoid, essentially, for one pixel, just these, if I'm just using these two points of information, this ellipsoid can be treated as sort of a probability density function that describes the possible locations of my object. Okay? The computer with just this information doesn't know where on the ellipsoid my target is sitting. But I have 1,024 pixels. And I can repeat this analysis for each individual pixel. And you can see immediately that, you know, if I have another same laser spot, I'm just measuring the return time now on a different pixel, it will give me a different ellipsoid, which is slightly shifted and tilted. Okay, but because this second ellipsoid is coming from the same target, it will have to overlap with this guy, at least at this point here. Okay, and the more pixels I use, the more ellipsoids I have, and then essentially I just treat this as a probability density product, so I just multiply all of these ellipsoids together, and because they will all overlap in one and only one place, I will end up with a kind of like a banana shape over here that gives me the final location of the hidden object. So it's very simple. These kind of details about how you can obtain background subtraction, I don't really want to go there, but I just want to show you sort of the final result. This is real-time tracking of a hidden object, okay? I'm not trying to retrieve the shape of the object, but I'm trying to track him in real time. The crosses show the ground truth positions of the hidden target, and this is showing sort of the result calculations the computer keeps on updating. So every second it pulls in new data and updates the probability distribution function for the hidden object. Okay, so this is with, yeah?
In order to get this to work, you have to have background data from
So I will take a step back then. Let's look at the background data. So you can do one of two things. You can either take, yes, so you do need background data because you'll not only have reflections from the person or the object that you want to track, wall, ceiling, floors, chairs, anything in the room will give you a return signal, and things can become very complicated very quickly. Okay? you can do actually, I'd say, one of three things. You can either try to use all of that information to pull out a full 3D reconstruction of the whole environment. That's fine, and we're trying to do that. And a group at MIT Media Labs, that was one of the things they actually tried to do back in 2012, using their street camera technology. The question we were trying to ask, so the problem with doing that, at least with using a street camera and using the algorithm developed by Andreas Velten and co-workers, is that it took several hours to do that measurement and analyze the data. Okay. If you, on the other hand, want real-time feedback on is there someone in the room, are they moving, where are they? Okay. So it's a very different question. I don't want to reconstruct the full shape of the room or what's going on. Okay. And so we're asking a different question. Now, in this situation, you can do one of two things. You can either have access or get access somehow to an object-free measurement of the background, and that's this... I think it's the blue curve here, okay? And you can see all these reflections here, all these peaks in the histogram. I don't know where they're coming from because you didn't try to analyze this, but this could be the opposite floor, this could be the ceiling, this could be different objects hidden in the environment, okay? And then you just subtract that out of your data. Alternatively, because the object, if you're looking for something that is moving, then all you do is you just keep on acquiring, and because the object is moving during the acquisition, you can see here, here's different, eight different acquisitions. You can see that there's a part of the signal which is always constant, that's the background, and there's a part that is changing in time. Okay, so I can just take some acquisitions, take the average or the median or whatever you, whatever you prefer, and I will end up with this red curve, which is essentially identical to the real background signal, and then I can subtract that out. And once you've got the background, that's a one-off measurement, and you just keep on subtracting it, and each time now you will be able to isolate the signal that you're interested in. And that's exactly what we were doing here. And you can do similarly, you can have one target, you can have two different targets moving here, sort of the banana-shaped ellipsoids that I was talking about earlier on. Here you can see them clearly as a result of the multiplication of all these separate ellipsoids. If there are two targets hidden from view, then you'll have, this again is raw data, you'll have sort of two signals that pass through your field of view. Now, what I didn't mention, well, I guess you can see it here, the dimensions are relatively small. Okay, so with these first measurements that we published in Nature Photonics in January 2016 were sort of, it was on an optical bench. It was a small scale thing, as all measurements of this type had been up until now. And so the question is, that's all very well and good, but how can I make this into something useful? Ideally, what you want to be able to do is maybe take this outdoors, and I want it to work over many, many meters, and I want to be able to detect maybe people. I don't want to be able to detect a piece of polystyrene moving in my lab. There's no real use to that. So first thing we tried to do was to use this setup to detect people. So these are the ground truths. This was an actual optical table. It was in the lab. And here the dimensions are slightly bigger. We're a few meters now. And we can detect, just again, this is the raw data showing the sort of the these banana shapes showing the probability distribution functions. There's a little bit of error, so this is offset by some 20, 30 centimeters, but it's still working relatively well. And I will show you how we managed to make that better. So here is sort of another overview of the same situation, and you can see the three different positions, three different histograms. I want to return to this later on, but you can already see just from here that the three histograms, actually, even by eye, they look quite different. And the question one can ask is, well, for example, here's another example of our student dressed different ways. Black trousers and a shirt, you have this histogram, black trousers and a white shirt. Very different histogram. Can I use that to do something useful? So the one of the things we've been struggling with before going to the details, looking sort of at the details of these histograms, is precisely to try and extend the distance over which you can make this technology work. And the question is, can we extend this to for example, 100 meter standoff distances. So I'm here, there's a building 100 meters away. Can I tell you what's going on in that building just by standing over here and shining a laser at the building? So the camera we're using at the moment has a slight problem. So its strength is that it has in each individual pixel, it has all the TCSPC electronics needed to provide this kind of timing. But what that means is that there's very little in each individual pixel, there's very little space left for the actual light-sensitive piece of silicon. Okay, so the final result is that you actually have something like a 1% fill factor. And then when you go out there, so why could we only detect a signal from a person from a few meters away? It's because the signal decays. Think of how the signal is decaying. These are spherical waves. I send out the laser beam. There's no decay there. Hits the wall, 1 over d squared decay. It hits the object or the walls, whatever, has to come back. That's another 1 over d squared decay. Then hits the wall that I'm trying to image and has to scatter back to the camera, another 1 over d squared decay. Okay, so it's 1 over d to the sixth power. That's bad. So that's a problem. Single photon technology can save the day, but it can't do miracles. So if you only have a 1% fill factor, that's a bit of a killer, and really limits sort of the distances over which you can work. And so what we've been looking at is we've been going back to single pixel detectors. For this specific application, it's a triangulation problem. So strictly speaking, you only need 3 points. You don't need 1,024 pixels to solve a triangulation problem. Okay? And the advantage in going back to single pixel detectors is that now you can have 100% fill factor. All the light that you can collect will all end up on your SPAD. So I think I'll jump through this, but essentially we did some test trials, trial tests first, where we just had, again, we had a small 1 by 1 meter box. We had a little window carved out of it, and we were trying to detect this moving piece of paper, essentially, using just one laser and three individual pixels. There is a postdoc underneath here who is moving our target. You can see him, yeah. And this is real-time data, so it's working extremely well. You know, the distances are small, but you can see that as this thing moves, there's a slight time lag due to the retrieval algorithm working in the background, but we can definitely track this thing in real time and quite precisely and actually see that he's moving along this sort of letter E, okay? So then the question is, how far can we really go? And we have a 50-meter corridor. This is just my lab. The door to my lab is just here. Got a 50-meter corridor, and we just repeated. And this time we had, right down the end there, we have a wall, and we are hiding people just around the corner. And so this is the kind of data that you get. We actually had two people. Whilst we're about it, we said, let's see if we can detect multiple targets. This is why you have one was closer, one was further away. One was also dressed in white, one was dressed in black, just to see how things work. And this is the actual final retrieval. So you can see, note here, this is distance from the detector in 53 meters. And this is the position of the, this is the ground truth. And you can see that we're retrieving their position quite precisely. Okay, we can't go too far yet away from the corner because, again, remember this 1 over d to the 6th power decay. We know how to fix the decay in this direction, but we still have a 1 over d to the 4th power decay along this axis, but we're working on that. But I think this is quite impressive, and we know from how things are scaling that we should be able to go even all the way up to 500 meters without too much effort. It's just a question now of finding somewhere where we can go and shine a 1-watt laser across 500-meter space. But this is doable. Oh, and I should mention, by the way, all previous work was done in the visible. Some of it with eye-safe lasers, some wasn't. This was eye-safe. So here we're working at the 1,500 nanometer wavelengths, and the beam is sufficiently defocused. We had 400 milliwatts power and sufficiently defocused to qualify as being eye safe at these wavelengths. I'll skip this. So you can read a little bit more of this at least the small scale stuff in this Nature Photonics paper. The long scale stuff, we'll see. We're fighting with the referee because apparently it's too simple, but we'll see. We also have an app. If you want to learn how this actually works, we've got an app where you can play around and you can see this working. Then you can go into game mode where this disappears and you see some data and you're supposed to try and figure out where the object is. Unfortunately, it's only for Apple iPhones, but it's good fun if you can get hold of it. Okay, so let's go back to looking at the shape. Milo, how much time do I have? 10 minutes. Okay, I'll go very quickly through the rest because there are several things I wanted to show you. So let's go back very quickly to look at the fact that these histograms can have different shapes. What's new in there and what can I do with that? And one of the things we started asking ourselves, well, I mentioned earlier on that you can use the multiple returns, if you can see multiple returns, to try and build a full 3D image of an object. Now, to do that, though, you need extremely good temporal resolution. You know, if your temporal resolution starts to broaden out and is of the order 100 picoseconds, you won't be able to see features or difference in features smaller than a couple of centimeters, half an inch. Okay, so if I want to recognize a person, I really need sort of like femtosecond temporal resolution. That's really hard. Is there something that we can still do anyway to maybe actually try and recognize, identify who is behind a corner without actually having to go through the whole process of a full 3D reconstruction? And do I need a camera? Can I just do that with a single pixel? So no spatial information now. I'm just using the temporal information to say that it's Jerry or it's Miro who's hiding behind the corner. So the point here is that the temporal histogram does contain information about the object shape. We know that. We see that. The temporal response smears the histogram, so it limits this information to some extent, as I pointed out. The interesting thing, and this is what we're actually, it looks like a bad thing, but it's what we're using to our advantage. There is a lack of any obvious algorithm that allows you to identify an object or a person just from a single pixel temporal histogram. I wouldn't know how to do it. I'm not even sure it can be done. You also have a very wide range of parameters. I have no idea of which parameters are important. Is skin color important? Is dress, the way you're dressed, important? Is how tall, how thin you are? Female, male? I mean, I have not. The length of your hair, no hair, lots of hair? No idea. And trying to model this could take years. And the point is that you can use that to your information, because what comes to sort of save the day is machine learning. One of the sort of the ideal circumstances or situation in which you want to use machine learning is precisely where you don't have a precise model of how to sort of understand what you're looking at. Okay? Think, for example, of how our brain interprets the difference between a cat and dog. To us, it's obvious. You know, our brains have been trained to immediately distinguish a cat from a dog. Now try and sit down and write an algorithm or definition of what makes a cat and what makes a dog, independently of the environment, independently of all the parameters that could define a cat or a dog. And I think you'll very quickly run into trouble. Okay, I tried doing this, and it's very hard. And the point is that that's not how the brain works. Okay, and that's precisely the point behind machine learning. Okay, I don't need to feed it. It's actually the absence of a clear algorithm to define the object that makes machine learning so interesting. So what we're doing is, it's just textbook. I am no expert in machine learning. Don't ask me the details of this, because or if it can be made better, I guess it can. We just took a book, literally, Machine Learning in Python, I think is the name, and we just copy out the code. There's a very famous code which is used for identifying handwritten numbers. Okay, it's just a classification scheme, essentially. And that's precisely what we want. We want to classify objects. We want to classify Miro. We want to classify Jerry, or classify a cat and classify a dog. Okay, so these really are details. Let's just go through these. But essentially what we're doing is We've got a supervised training algorithm. That means I give the camera or the computer a set of data and to train on, and I say, okay, this set of data corresponds to Miro behind a corner. This set of data corresponds to Jerry behind a corner. And one of the key points, though, in machine learning is that you have to give it lots of data. Okay, you will not learn what a cat looks like by looking at just one image of a cat. You need thousands of images. So how do we do this? So we're using the fact that the camera has 1,024 pixels. And when we started off, it looks a bit daunting because I thought, okay, we just want to use one pixel. There's no way I'm going to convince the students to go and take 10,000 sets of data using individual pixel with the person sort of shifting around. It would take weeks or months. But we have 1,024 pixels in our camera. So in a single shot, we've got 1,000 sets of data, 1,024 sets of individual pixel data that we can use to train the algorithm. And essentially what we're doing is just to try and remove, again, any dependence on parameters or variables that we're not aware of. We just took multiple sets of data over different days, you know, so very similar setting, but just repeated because you never know. Okay, let's just remove the variability out of the equation just by keep on repeating and feeding it the data. So we had essentially at the end three sets of data, and we're always using two sets of the data to train. So for Miro I have two sets, and for Jerry I'll have two sets, and I'm just using the two sets of data to train the computer, and then I'm using the third set to essentially test it and see how well it's working. And we did various things. So we had three different people. We had the people in different positions and with different and same clothes. So this is sort of an overview of what the setup looked like. So I had a person. We just had a wall shining the laser, pulse laser, onto the wall, and then just collecting the data. And for these sort of, these roughly speaking, these are the positions that we were testing. These are the students who actually participated in the experiment. So we have Gabriella, Alessandro, and Pier Giorgio, all Italian. I don't think it's working just because they're Italian, so I hope not. But there is one constant in all these measurements, and with different clothes. And then we tried on a different day where they were all dressed in exactly the same way, using the sort of green top, the same green top, and the same trousers. Okay, so this is what the data looks like. We don't need to go into too much details, but one means that I gave this thing, I trained it, and I gave it 1,000 sets of test data, and 1,000 times out of 1,000, it recognized the right person. Okay, so it's a probability, if you want. I'm using these 1,000 data points to build up a probability of how well the thing is actually working. Now, you can see when the Ale, Gab, and Pierre are wearing different clothes. Now, Pierre, it works quite well. All yellow means, so here, essentially, 100% of the time, it was getting Pierre. Here, this is different training sets. Most of the time, and here too, most of the time, it's working quite well. But Pierre was very different, sort of his shape is very different from the other two guys. And you can see if we go and look at Ale and Gabriella, it's the machine is making quite a bit of confusion. Here, it's not even 50% of the time it's getting it right. So clearly, there's a problem. If two people have similar physiognomy and they're dressed differently, the parameters just mix up. And they can be in different positions, dressed differently, and all the parameters add up. And even if they shouldn't, they give very similarly looking histograms, and the computer isn't able to distinguish who he's looking at. Now, the same happens if you change positions. So this wasn't a position-dependent thing. We tried different positions, and essentially Pierre is always recognizable. The other two guys, not really. I wouldn't trust it. Now, the miracle happened when we tried giving them the same clothes. Now, all of a sudden, it's nearly 100% hit every single time. So different sets of data, you can see essentially that the computer is able, with nearly 100%, so on average, we're talking about more than 90% certainty, is able to identify the person, the identity of the person hidden behind a corner. I don't know how that's possible. I just don't know what it's detecting, but somehow, when two people, you know, Pierre and Gabriele, Alessandro Gabriele look very similar, they put on the same clothes, and now the computer is really able to distinguish exactly who the person is, just from the physiognomy. I don't know if it's hair color or whatever, but somehow it's managing to do this. I found that, I don't understand why, but it's astonishing. And just to give an idea, this is what the actual histograms look like. So I don't know what to make of this, but the computer is able to reconstruct exactly who is who from this data. Okay, so I'll move on. Have I got another 10 minutes? Quickly? Okay, I'll be quick. I'll just very, very quickly skim through this. Another sort of topic that we started looking at, which I think is a very exciting, big topic, imaging through diffusive media. Why are we interested? Well, the ultimate goal that we're aiming for here is to be able to image directly inside the human body. So you can do away with PET scans or X-rays. You just use a laser and a camera. Can I see directly what's going on inside me? Okay. And this was stimulated by this. This is this video here. This is a postdoc arm. And what we're doing is we're shining the laser from behind and just imaging what's going on. The time scale here, I'm not showing it, but it's very long. Okay, it's nanoseconds. So I'm sending in a 100 femtosecond pulse. The fact that it's nanoseconds means that the light inside the body is traveling many, many meters. Okay, so or many, many feet, depending on your units of measure. So the question is, and you can definitely see structure, okay? And then, so the question is, what does that structure mean? Does it actually mean anything? And it's a very naive and probably wrong way of thinking, but the reasoning is, if the photons stay in here for so long, surely there must be some way of extracting that information. They've been in there in your arm or in your body for ages. They must have seen lots. So is there any way that I can pull that information out? The answer is probably not really, or somewhere in the middle. So there's this work again by collaborators at MIT. They were using timing. So this is all about timing. I'm not going to go into the details of other techniques that people are using. I mean, there's a whole, you can imagine, there's a huge industry out there, people trying to do this. But what can I get out of the timing information? Now, these guys did something slightly different from what I would want to do when I want to look inside a human body. They created a mask and then illuminated a diffusive material through that mask. And you can see that even without doing anything special, at the output, you can already see that there's, you know, you kind of make out what the shape of the mask was. Okay, it's kind of a letter A, kind of a V. Then they apply some fancy retrieval technique. And I agree, this is much better, okay? But there was already some information there. What we've been trying to do is something which I think is a bit harder and may or may not work. We might fail, but why not? What we're trying to do is see an opaque object, so we just embedded in equally opaque surrounding medium. Okay, this here is just shown to be sort of semi-transparent to show you the kind of object that we're looking at. But can I see something? My body's completely opaque to light. Can I use light nevertheless to see what's inside me? This is what the setup really looks like. This is our little piece of plastic X. And you can see this is polyurethane. It's completely opaque. Okay, the thickness of this guy, if that means anything to any of you, but the total thickness is about 400 scattering lengths. The best I've ever seen in literature, that people usually sort of deal with 20, 30 scattering lengths and try to retrieve what's going on. Now, so if I shine the laser from behind and just look at, so look in transmission, so I'll close these over, try and look, so it's 2.5 centimeters, an inch of diffusion, object, another inch of diffusion. If I look at a single pixel, this is what I'll get, and you can very nicely fit your data with a standard sort of analytical solution to the diffusion equation for photons. And this is what the data looks like, have different objects. What people usually do, a standard technique, is to use what are called the ballistic or the snake photons. These are the photons that somehow manage to make it directly through. And if you can gate those out using your time resolution, typically you can see something. But here we're so strongly diffusive. Remember, 400 scattering lengths. It's a bit like looking through your arm, actually. It's huge. There is no information at all. I mean, these are just blobs. There's absolutely nothing to be seen here. What we do then is that we just make initial guess for what the object might look like, some random blob, and we put it through a circular sort of retrieval algorithm where we compare the initial guess. So we go essentially, the diffusion equation can be solved analytically. So you put in your initial guess, solve the diffusion equation, adjust the guess function, and keep on going around in circles and hope that it converges. Won't go into the details of exactly what we're doing, but this is what we get. And I thought that was pretty spectacular. From a very undefined blob, you can actually pull something out. It's not fantastic, but I think it's close enough to be able to decide what letter of the alphabet this is. Now, I'm only showing you, this is all work in progress, I'm only showing you the very best result that we got. 99% of the time, you get something, but I wouldn't call it an X. It's sort of a blob. We're still trying to figure out what the variable is here that's making the difference between good data and bad data. We haven't figured it out. But it can. I think the message is we're going to nail it down at some point, but it can work. It worked once. We just need to make it work all the time. So I'll very, very briefly just run through this because it's fun. So leaving aside the applications for a moment, let's go back to having fun. I remember as a student reading, I don't know why I was reading this book because it's terrible. I mean, it's not a good read. But Lord Rayleigh's book, The Theory of Sound, written in 1896 language, he says something fascinating. He's talking about the Doppler shift. And now he says, if the speed of the emitter is 2 times the speed of sound, the observer will hear a musical piece in correct time and tune, but backwards. And I remember that sort of sticking in my mind. I mean, this is fascinating. So essentially what he's saying is that he sort of has some kind of time reversal. And we'll see in a few slides exactly how, so that, what we mean by that time, but is it really time reversal? But you can already see, you can build sort of an intuitive picture of what's going on here. Imagine you have one of these jets that have been flying over campus the past days. If it's supersonic, so at time t1, it will emit a click. Okay, I'm over here just standing still and waiting to hear that click. Then at time t2, this will emit another click. Okay, but because the plane is supersonic, it will have left behind the sound wave that it emitted at t1. And I know, the guy on the airplane, somebody knows, that t1 was before t2. But what I hear over here is t2 and then t1. Okay? So a very simple geometric picture, that's where the time reversal comes from. And this is sort of just a graphical representation of the same thing. I think I'll move forward with this. But the point is that, I actually do have to stop here. So the problem is, if you actually want to do this, you run into trouble. Because if you want to be able to discern a piece of music or something, let's say a few seconds of music, and you go through the math, so sound travels in air at 300 meters per second, how far away does the plane have to be when it emits the first 3 seconds of music? It's a few kilometers, it's a couple of miles away. And attenuation through air just simply doesn't allow you. I mean, unless this guy is carrying massive sort of Pink Floyd scale speakers, you're not going to be able to hear anything. So you really can't, nobody had seen this or heard this, you just can't do the experiment. But you can do it with light. I can create a superluminal source, and I can try to do this experiment using light and using this technology to capture light in flight. Before saying how we do this, let's have a look at a Minkowski diagram. I've got time here and space here. In the subluminal case, I'll have my world line of sort of this, my emitter moving along will be time-like. This is my detector world line, just, you know, same position for all times. So light emitted from here will hit my detector here, and light emitted from this point will hit the detector here. So the object is moving upwards and forwards in time, and I also see my signal moving forwards in time. Everything's good. If I'm going superluminal, my world line becomes space-like, and the whole situation gets inverted. This now becomes the point of detection of emission at T1, but T2 now gets detected down here. And if I look at the arrow of time, it's going in the opposite direction. You really are inverting the temporal direction of the evolution of the system. So how do I get a superluminal light source? I mean, that's clearly the big sort of problem here. But actually, it's very simple. Think of a plane wave hitting a wall, okay? And let's assume the wall is rough, so it's scattering. It's not a mirror. It's a rough wall that's scattering light. And all I'm interested in, so I will see this. I mean, I've already shown you, right? Those spherical waves that were propagating against the blackboard background. That's exactly what I'm talking about. How fast is that spherical wave, is that light that I'm seeing, the spherical front, moving across the piece of blackboard? Well, the answer is it has only one and one only option. It can only move at superluminal speeds. It's just a piece, very simple piece of trigonometry. It's the speed of this along the direction of the wall is c divided by sine theta. Every time you switch, let's go back to the very first slide I showed you. Every time you switch on the lights in the room, the light bulb will emit a sphere of light. The intersection of those waves as they move across the wall will be moving at c over sine theta, greater than the speed of light. Okay? So that's what we're going to use. This is kind of a virtual source. Of course, it's not a real light bulb. I wouldn't be able to do that at superluminal speeds. This guy is a virtual source, a scattering source. He can move faster than the speed of light without violating any fundamental principle of physics. Now, what I need, though, is I need the superluminal speed to be in the direction between the object and the observer. So if the camera is here, it's not this speed I'm interested in. It's this component. Again, trigonometry, I won't go through the details, but that can also be made superluminal or subluminal just by changing the angle of the screen. Okay, so this is the experiment, very simple. I have a plane wave, just a defocused 100 femtoseconds laser beam hitting a screen, and I'm looking at it, and I'm from this side, and I'm just changing the angle to go from sub to superluminal. Okay, so in the subluminal case, this side hits this edge first and then moves across in this direction. And that's exactly what I measure. Okay, so I've tuned the angle so that this wavefront is moving. The component in the direction of the camera is 0.5C. But I can now change that angle to make it go at 2 times C, and it's propagating the opposite direction. Okay, remember, this is a wavefront. We know very well what's going on here. The wavefront is moving from left to right, but this is what I measure. So verified that, you can then start playing around with this. You can put a curved surface so that you transition from sub to superluminal. And in this case, and there are people working on tachyon physics and stuff like this, have predicted that if you could have a transition from sub to superluminal, you should see a splitting of the image of the object. And depending whether you go sub, super, super, sub, you'll either see an image split and go in opposite directions, or you'll see two images come in and converge and annihilate. And so that's exactly what we see. We're going from, I can't remember if this is sub, I think this is from sub to super. You see the two images come in and collide, and you see the opposite. You see one image move out and separate. Remember, we know that on the screen, this is not some trick, geometrical trick. We had a discussion with one of the referees about this. It's not some geometrical trick where I have a curved surface and a plane wave coming down. Of course, I have two images or two spots. That's not what we're doing. We know that there is one and only one intersection point between the plane wave and the screen, yet this is what we see because of this temporal inversion that can be captured with these kind of cameras. So you can find more about this in this Science Advances paper that we published last year, and I think I'll stop here. Thank you.